2011. So that, the shed clearly visible, and if we go 3 months later, we already see this small strip developing. October even more. So mainly the northern part is changing. And then January, after a couple of storms, you see this pit, it's of course low tide now, but you see this pit and this large gully where the man was talking about created. And then it continues on and on and on. So this is 2 years later after construction. You see that the gully is already slowly meandering, like gets the curves, the bends. And this is a recent picture on this one this year, where you see that slowly we do not have one gully, but several gullies start to develop. And so nothing mechanical, but it's all nature. The currents, the waves, and the wind. And now, one thing to mention is what the sand monitor, what makes it so unique. And according to us, it's the large volume, which is concentrated on one location. It's skilled, it's 2 kilometers longshore, and it's emerged. Normally, shore-fresh versions were submerged, so they don't have any benefits from recreational point of view. And this is emerged. It's a combination of functions: safety, recreation, nature development, but also knowledge development. Very interesting for us. It's walkable and it's dynamic. So every time you go there, a couple of weeks later, it's different. So it attracts people. Yeah. Any questions related to the movie or my part?
You mentioned that it's dynamic. It's constantly changing. When you designed it originally, the wind and the current, is it constant on that in that area? Does it always come from the northeast, or does it come from the northeast and sometimes from the southwest? And how do you determine the shape, the initial shape? And is the wind always coming, is the sea always coming from the same
place? No. In Holland, we have about 2 main directions. The most storms come from the southwest, and the largest storms less often come from the northwest. So they affect the current, the vent, the motor on both sides. Depends on which storms you get in the first couple of years, the shape of the sand could have been different, because you cannot predict weather. But if you go to the longer term, if you look at 5, 10, 15 years, it doesn't really make a difference which storms, what sequence of storms would have occurred. And shape, yeah, that's just a combination of the province and the Rijksdienst, Ministry of Public Works. They're looking for, let's say, surface area for recreation, but also for dune development, nature development. The island was clearly not ideal for recreational point of view. People cannot walk to it. The port was not spectacular enough. It's already symmetric, but you see after some 3 years, it's getting more and more symmetric. And the submerged point is also clearly not interesting for the migration. Yeah.
If I could just add to that. I think what you were asking is basically how do we know how it's going to develop?
Well, just thinking in terms of how we share. Okay, sometimes the wind comes from the northeast.
Yeah.
Sometimes the wind comes from the southwest.
Yeah.
So the winds are coming from different directions.
That's why, what I just explained, we have waves from different directions. We basically use models to schematize these directions as the wave approach and making predictions for how the shape is going to develop. And actually, now that I've been around for 3 years almost, or for 3 years. And it's basically developing as it was predicted. So it's, that's
One question I'm sorry, I'd like to during certain time of the year, or each year, during the winter months, January to April, you would tend to have what is considered as a lot of north. Everything seems to come from the north. The month of September, October, November, everything seems to come from your northwest or your southwest. So if that would give you an idea how our movements of sand would be, then it would be that sometimes, certain time of year, it comes from that direction, certain time it comes from that direction. Yeah. So I don't know what that is.
Yeah, that's a bit knowledge on historical data on where all the waves have come from and over the past. That's crucial if you want to look into the future. You want to make predictions, you have to know these facts.
Yes.
And preferably also data from fields, so wave pools to actually measure the height of the waves. Well, in Holland we have that data, and many other countries in the world not. But there are sources, ocean wave models that can provide you insights in the wave climates that occur. And it's just realizing that you have different seasons with different waves, different winds, that's already good to know that, keep that in your mind when you start designing or thinking about such a solution. And it's good to include it, you must include it.
Yes.
Yeah, just an observation. before we were a tourist resort, and then all of our hotels lined the beaches for the full length of the bay. Initially, when the sand is mined and then placed in the ocean, your concept is that based on the ocean currents over a period of time, the sand would be distributed onto the beach. Am I correct in saying this?
Yes.
Okay. So let's say we're a guest, we're not looking at the situation like this. We're running a hotel. A guest wants to stay with us for 5-7 days. They want to have easy access to the ocean. And to me, by what I have seen there, is that it would take quite some time. And some properties may be at a disadvantage of having their guests have easy access to the ocean. Would I be correct in saying this? Based on the concept that I see there?
The concept that we presented is indeed concentrated launchments. So that means that the location where you place your launchment, you have a wider reach at that time.
Yeah.
That's preferable or not. If you have a wider beach, it's nice, but if it's too wide, it's not nice because you have to walk further to the waterline. But if it's somewhere, have to have something in between. But yeah, the concept here is to place it on one location and over time it will feed surrounding growth so that indeed some resort areas will be, will be profiting later.
Yeah, but initially now, some resorts will be at a distinct disadvantage to other resorts in that their guests can have easy access to the ocean, whereas in some resorts now will not have that easy access initially to the ocean.
Well,
because it's going to take time for, by just what I've been, for the ocean currents to distribute the sand, you know, on the coastline to create the equivalent of what you would not have over there.
Yeah, I'm not so much involved here exactly in the access, because the access to the beach remains there as it is now.
Yeah, but the access to the actual ocean. You have access to the beach, yes. So you have the sand there, but you have quite a distance to actually enter the water.
Enter the water,
swimming.
Yeah, right. True. Yeah. But again, this is one design of the concept. They can think of different designs.
No, but I'm just basing on what the design that you that you have shown us, and then we have to start based on the design.
That's for inspiration.
I believe that obviously if I might say what Nero thinks is, if you see the beaches in Netherlands, obviously having a kilometer before you reach the ocean is something that is just like kind of a vision. If a guest from your swept away has to walk 1 kilometer before he can put his foot in the Caribbean, then definitely he's not interested that in a few years we have a beautiful Negril beach because he has to take a vehicle to go to the beach. I think this is what the picture tries to create. And I believe that the size and scale of your nourishment is probably not what would be thought of Negril. So I believe that's a picture, obviously not a kilometer going to the... I think that's something we might have to discuss later.
Could be
the translation for a beach like Negril, because at the moment we just see these sizes, gigantic cars driving up, and I was like, holy moly. And I would believe that
please use it as inspiration for further ideas. But Tim will touch upon that as well. Last question, then we continue.
Yeah, Negril, can you put an island sat motor offshore? If you do when you do a study, rather than have it attached to the shore like you did in the Netherlands, then it would really take a lot of over time.
Yeah, I think it's very much discussable. Things are possible, but depends on what you call offshore. Let's continue discussion after the remaining presentations. Yeah.
Thank you. Oh, my name is Vera. I hope you don't mind if I move around a little bit. I'm really freezing. I don't want to stay in the line just yet. Okay, so I would like to talk about the concept. So the broader concept behind the scent engine. The scent engine is just one example of building with nature. And building with nature is, it actually has to do, it's a philosophy. It has to do with all types of projects which take place on the interface of water and land. So it's not only sand nourishment, it's not only combating beach erosion, it's also about harbors or estuaries or deltas and developments in those areas. So how the concept emerged is actually, it was triggered by the increasing pressure on coastal zones and deltas. Because more and more people live in coastal zones, there's economic growth, which is a good thing, but at the same time, there is more pressure on the environment. More economic activities take place in on the coast, for example, industry development, and harbors, but also tourism. As more and more people live in the coastal zones, there's more pressure on the environment, so there's environmental degradation. You can see some, I added some pictures, I think perhaps you recognize also from the situation there. But also in Europe, in the European context, there's a strong environmental movement which started in the 70s, but its role is increasing, and so the environmental legislation is also becoming more stringent. So marine contractors and also local authorities have more and more difficulty to comply with the legislation, because legislation is also really enforced. So actually, what the marine contractors and all the governments they came up with is that perhaps instead of doing bad for the minimizing effects of economic development in coastal zones and deltas, we could actually take it from another, look at it from another perspective. And so that instead of doing less bad, you actually try to improve environment. So that is that you can call that a paradigm shift in water engineering. I will give some examples from the Dutch context. So in the early 70s, the design of the delta works started. That's the delta area you can see in the map of Irene's presentation. So the design started in the 70s, also the first environmental movement started in the 70s. It was completed in 1986, the reconstruction of the Eastern Shelf area. And that's an example of building in nature. So actually you, as a government, you try to minimize the effect on the environment while executing water infrastructure projects. So also, in this case, coastal protection, closing off the delta of the river. And then slowly the thinking has changed towards building off nature, so that it has to be developed also of EU legislations, more strict regulations. The compensation was required for damaging the environment. Compensation mitigation measure. So an example of that is second extension of the Port of Rotterdam. And so you can see it slowly, the shift is starting to take place towards softer solutions. And finally, sand engine, well, Irene talked a lot about that, is an example of building with nature. So that's actually using the natural dynamics of the system as a starting point. So it's no longer thinking of, okay, this seeing environment as an enemy. It's more seeing nature as your, cooperative nature. So the definition of what actually comes down to building the nature is a design process for water infrastructure, which integrates nature and development goals. And it can be development goals can be various. In, for example, in the sense engine case, it was recreation, but also knowledge development. It also, the second aspect is using natural processes. So actually you and you have a look at the system, what are the dynamics present there, and you try to employ them. So in the case of sand engine, the wind, the currents, and waves that distribute the sand. And in the end, it's about creating the added value for society. But also, of course, in terms of, it has to do with the goal of the project. So, this building in nature type of projects are starting to take place more and more in the Netherlands in several locations. You can see I have a small map. The red ones, the red dots, already projects, executed projects, so you can see they're not only along the coast, but also inland. There are a few examples. And the yellow dots are the ones that are in preparation. So this is a bit broader than just sand nourishment. This is more thinking in terms of working with nature. Also, building nature is you should see it more as a scale. It's not hard or soft, so it's not that black or white. It's you also have solutions in between, so you have scale. Sand engine being the example of the soft, and then for example oyster reefs in the eastern delta of in the south delta of the Netherlands. It's a sort of combination of hard structure, but using oysters or natural material to strengthen the sandbanks. So, in fact, any questions? Did I get something? Okay, so in the upper row, I have examples from the Netherlands, and the row down below is from abroad. So there's also examples of application of building in nature in tropical ecosystems. I did not personally study those, but there are more examples. For example, seagrass, mangroves are in Singapore, rich trees. So it's the concept of building nature is much broader than sand nourishment. That's the message that I want to give here. Also, another interesting aspect of building nature is that it's a recognition of the three domains. So it's no longer just to water engineering like sector, but it's also the recognition that there is nature and society, also in terms of so what this means is think differently. It's just first acknowledgement that it's not no longer solely water engineering, but also nature ecology, ecosystem services, and society. So you can no longer, as a government, execute a project just solely for coastal protection. You have to take into consideration the other stakeholders and ecosystems. But it's also acting differently, so it's about employing natural processes in the design of your project. And it's interacting differently. So it's actually today, now you can see as a team, we come from different disciplines. We have social scientists, we have a coastal engineer, and also a physical geographer. So it's also about having a multidisciplinary team of experts. So now I will talk a little bit about the more societal domain, this corner. So actually this the societal domain is, in our research we refer to it as governance. And governance as a term has emerged in the late 90s and it has been promoted by large international, transnational organizations like the UN, World Bank, and the EU. And actually, it's directly governance, but actually, it comes down to the different role of state. The state is no longer sort of command and control type of actor. It's the approach is changing towards more steering at a distance. What does this mean is that the non-state actors are also recognized and they get their role in the decision-making process. So non-state actors such as market parties, so the stakeholders with a commercial interest in the project or the area. It's NGOs and local stakeholders, perhaps those without an explicit commercial interest, but with the state. Also, governance takes place in networks and at multiple levels. So it's from the grassroots level up to the government level, and also networks in terms of, for example, our research program can be seen as a network, it's a lot of knowledge and specialists that have been executing each nourishment, a lot of experience. So also that a stronger role in the decision-making process. Actually, the Tyrus is an institute has in-house, they are the in-house experts of Reichswaldstaffel, the National Ministry of Public Works. So all in all, it's sort of, you can see it as a transfer from a government towards governance as the process. Now I'll give just a few highlights from the sand engine case, just to a little bit to make the concept of governance more. So sand engine, also I didn't mention that it had the gold project was threefold, so it's coastal protection, but also nature and recreation. development, like kitesurfing, extra area for the province citizens to recreate, and knowledge development, so like our research program is part of it. So it's not no longer, like I explained, it's no longer well, just pure water engineering, coastal protection, it's more from an integrated perspective. Also in the sand engine, a lot of actors were involved, and by that I mean there were structurally involved, there were regular meetings between the ministry, provinces, municipalities, NGOs and local stakeholders, where stakeholders could raise their concerns about the effects of the sand engine. Also research institutes were involved, and those were experts from several disciplines. This is also quite special because usually when the government, well, the usual practice so far was that the Ministry of Public Works would hire coastal engineers, more from coastal anthropologists, and the projects would be designed to give them predominantly engineering financial concerns. So, and the last one that I wanted to highlight is that political and administrative support is very important for the execution of the sand engine. There was what we would refer to as a sand engine champion, that was a provincial governor, a lady actually who embraced and promoted this concept in the province, but also to, on the national level. There was a lot of media attention, and at the opening of the sand engine, she found it important to show that she took ownership of the project, and that was an important factor in the success. So I don't know if you could, because I'm not really familiar with the societal context in Jamaica, but I don't know if you can recognize any of this issues as present in Jamaican context or important. But for me, it would be interesting to look at the case of Jamaica in this point. So if you have any questions?
Not a question, but I can recognize the governance issues because some of the same things we're trying to implement here in Jamaica. One of the things I would suggest is that we be aware of what was created in 1957, right? The Beach Control Act. Because this is the document by which we here in Jamaica can either modify or change the coast. And I think it's important because this idea, and as we see it working, right, is a silver bullet that can work. But we have to structure it up. We are an island state with reefs all around. So we have to structure it so that we're not harming nature, but enhancing.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah? So perhaps part of what, as you're developing, since I don't think you've worked in a Caribbean country, correct? No. So you might have to begin also to develop that framework with regard to the island coastal zones.
And then you mean legislative?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Oh yeah. I know a couple of lawyers, don't worry. I can introduce you.
Okay.
I'd just like to say that maybe I didn't really do the introduction very well, because they're here to see if it's a possibility.
Correct.
And as Vera says, it's an all-encompassing thing. It's not like Vanor who will just come in, test to see if the sand is correct, do the job, and go. This is a wholesome approach to the problem, which will cover all different areas. And as Nero says, you know, we don't want a kilometer of sand in front of our property. I think they're going to have to look, first of all, they're looking to see if it's a possibility, because we have reefs and we have a different scenario. So first of all, they have to see whether it would work here to start with. So that's not really sure yet. So I think it's my fault. I didn't quite explain why we were here. So I just wanted to make that clear.
I would ask to get the government on our side.
This is the point.
To get them on our side. Remember, what happens is that you make your beach bigger, so your beach license gets more expensive.
This is the point I was going to make, because in your last statement you said about political and administrative things. I mean, our hardest part is to get, if this is decided, is to get our political people to buy into this holistic, without just talking about it, physically doing it. And this is it's going to be our challenge, is getting our political administration to buy into this. So we need guidance on how to get them to buy into it.
It will be interesting to research this.
Absolutely, very interesting.
But I think also it will not be as easy to understand.
From an environmental point of view, by concentrating the sand in one location and have it distribute itself over time, if that sand is going to carry over the seagrass, is that something that's going to be damaging to the seagrass, which is a vital part of the ecosystem, the thriving seagrass beds? I mean, could that be a deterrent to the sand engine?
Can I say something about that? That would be part of the research that you would do, because it is a different scenario here from what you have in Holland. We have the coral reefs, we have seagrass beds. So when they're doing their research and feasibility study, they would have to take all those elements into consideration to see what adjustments they would make and what they require if it could work here. Maybe there's something different
version. It
doesn't mean that what we saw on the
film
is not
the right.
So I
don't think
that
they would
be able to
give
an answer
immediately.
It's something that would be considered.
Yeah, likely possible that you put some sand in the south and some sand in the north, and they'd be together. And that would be based on your feasibility.
Yes, that's the kind of issues we would bring. Also, it's great that we have this session today, that we can note down the questions actually that you were asking, so that we take them into consideration and we consider what aspects we would be able to do.
What are the preliminary measures that would be in place to do the research?
Well, we are here today to find that out. Mm-hmm. This is our first visit, so we would like to.
How much testing will be done before the actual process?
We haven't decided that yet.
This is the initial stage.
They just arrived. We might know this hotel.
We are researchers, so we are interested in doing research. We are not today we are not proposing any measures for the next group. Is it any more questions? Can I give the floor to them?